Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Uncharted, a rediscovered history of voyages to the Americas before Columbus, by Tim Wallace-Murphy and James Martin. Narrated by Nigel Patterson. Preface. The origins of this book started around 2014, with Tim wanting to write a follow-up to the great book but strangely named Templars in America, as he put it. This book would chronicle, as best as possible, humanity's exploration of the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans in discovering the Americas before the time of Columbus. The focus was to source, as best as possible, and describe the exploration by various peoples to the Americas prior to 1492. Over a period of months, Tim began to coalesce his thoughts on the outline of the book. Soon he had produced the manuscript for this book, which, with some editing and additions, would have been ready for print. He decided not to do anything with the manuscript. It remains a mystery to me as to why he chose to do nothing with the book. I had asked why he hadn't wanted to progress the book, but more important projects awaited, he explained. Because I cared for Tim over the last few years of his life, alongside others, and because he was very much a father-like figure to me, some have suggested that he wanted to give this manuscript to me to complete, just as Trevor Ravenscroft had once done for him, something to which Tim had alluded to me on a few occasions. My real involvement in this book began in 2016 to 2020, while sitting at our favourite coffee shop in Quillan, France. Tim had begun to discuss a stalled project that he had been working on relating to proposed pre-Columbian transatlantic voyages. I remember that we had started our customary coffee that day at around 9:30, espresso for Tim, a café crème and a jus d'orange for me. We were joined by a mutual friend, a vicar from the southwest of England, and, as was often the case, by the time we had finished our morning coffee, it was afternoon. Imagine the scene. Two historians and a vicar locked into deep discussion. I can only imagine how our conversation must have sounded to a fly on the wall. By the close of the day, I had agreed to undertake an edit of the manuscript, and over the coming months, emails bounced between the two of us with different edits. It wasn't too long before I sought his permission to add a few sentences, then a few paragraphs, and then finally a few chapters. As I complete this work at the start of 2022, during the turbulence of the COVID-19 pandemic, I find myself reviewing the email exchanges between us, with one especially Wallace-Murphy-esque line having made me chuckle. "Well, you can add what you like to the book, dear boy. I can always delete it afterwards." Tim, even to the last. With this said, and more puzzling, whenever I attempted to discuss the additions and edits with him, as I wanted to do ever so frequently, I was met by the phrase, "Be in a slow hurry, dear boy," or "Let's look at it later." With this in mind, "A Slow Hurry" would be the best title for the book. I suppose I should begin some sort of introduction. The topic of pre-Columbian transatlantic exploration, other than a mouthful to say, is to many an exciting, if not controversial, one. Serious academics very seriously hold to the view that prior to Columbus, the notion of European or Asian travellers having any form of contact with the Americas is ridiculous. This said, however, developments and finds from the Americas that would be commonplace in Europe or Asia simply cannot be ignored or automatically dismissed as ridiculous. We present to you evidence, and yes, in some places speculation, that Columbus really didn't discover anything unknown. The Western-centric model of exploration deserves to be examined and other cultures respected. Furthermore, our modern view that ancient peoples were somehow backward, unsophisticated, or incapable is a notion simply untrue. We have used evidence in this book from a wide range of temporal periods, and given the sensitivities of the term exploration, which for some led to genocide and occupation, have attempted to be respectful and aware of the hardships faced by so many. With this in mind, in completing this book, I have sought to remember those who have, and still to this day do, suffered under conditions in which history still has taught us no lessons. Our mission in this book is not necessarily to educate, but it is to provoke, and to provoke you into thought about a side of history still so readily dismissed by some. I have attempted to capture both my own and Tim's passion for this topic, and as such I have, where possible and with evidence, looked to further the notion that they did not come to conquer. Tim, you asked me to edit, then add to this book, and, it seems in conversations you had with others, left for me to complete. I hope I have done you proud. James Martin. It should be noted that some authors quoted came from a school of now outdated and potentially offensive racial grouping, common throughout their own education. We have retained these quotes to demonstrate the topic at hand, exploration, not to cause offence. Introduction. There is a principle which is a barrier against all information, which is proof against all arguments, and which cannot fail to keep a man in everlasting ignorance. That principle is contempt prior to investigation. Herbert Spencer. Contempt prior to investigation and outright denial of reality are not attitudes restricted to fundamentalists of the religious or political persuasion alone. Sadly, this form of distorted thinking also infects parts of the academic world. This realm, which traditionally extols the virtues of proof, hard evidence, logical argument, and open-mindedness, is far from immune from a degree of denial that almost beggars belief. Nowhere is this more evident than in the study of early voyages to America. The official academic view that Columbus was the first European to reach the New World seems to be written in tablets of stone. It is not merely the dominant theory, it is the only one that is seriously discussed by American and European historians. The massive array of hard evidence to the contrary that has emerged over the past century or more has been denied, derided, ignored, or condemned as fake. When an artifact, such as the Vinland map, for example, is discovered, it is loudly and publicly denounced as a forgery. This announcement makes headline news and reinforces the public perception that Columbus was first. Whereas the later proof of its authenticity is reported only in obscure journals that ordinary citizens never read, and thus this news rarely impinges on the public consciousness. A significant corollary to the concept that Columbus was first is the definitive and equally rigid idea that there was no dissemination of Native American flora and fauna to the outside world until after 1492. The academic bias in favour of Columbus is also invariably applied to any artifact found within the United States, irrespective of its age or nature. If it is dated prior to 1492, it will be described as of Native American origin, ignored, or misfiled. For example, in 1943, James Howe bought a farm on the banks of the Roanoke River in Virginia. He found some bog iron on the farm and some slag, and guessed that he had stumbled across the traces of an old colonial forge. However, he could not find any records to substantiate this use, which was rather odd, as such a forge would undoubtedly have been important enough to be recorded. He continued his search and found over 400 pounds of iron and a natural draft furnace. He then began to excavate more carefully and found various quantities of iron at a depth of 80 centimetres. At that level, he also discovered a superb bronze cup in relatively good condition, two more fragments of bronze, and a bronze spindle. Finding bronze artifacts among the iron debris led to the conclusion that they must have been imported. Iron ore can be found in the locality, but neither tin nor copper, the constituent elements of bronze, occurs anywhere in the vicinity. Comparative studies of the bronze cup began to reveal some interesting facts. six cups of a similar type and of comparable metallurgy were found in the ruins of Pompeii and have been dated to a few years before the Common Era, indicating that they are over 2,000 years old. A nearly identical cup, also found in the US, is on exhibit in the Smithsonian Institution, and it is labelled with no date, merely a question mark. It is simply one such misleadingly labelled artefact among so many others on display there. An iron nail head found at a Roman site near Saalfeld Fort in Germany is dated as being manufactured about 200 BCE. An identical nail head found in America and exhibited in the Smithsonian again carries no date but merely another question mark. Yet, paradoxically enough, it was a professor from that very Smithsonian institution who finally broke ranks and made a breach in the wall of denial erected by American academics on the subject of pre-Columbian voyages to America. He did it using archaeology and modern science, namely DNA studies. The theory first put forward by Dennis Stanford, chairman of the anthropology department of the Smithsonian Institution, and Bruce Bradley, an independent researcher, in 1999, is referred to as the Solutrean hypothesis. Stanford and Bradley claim that some of America's early inhabitants crossed the Atlantic from Europe a little more than 18,000 years ago, from an area that encompasses Spain, Portugal, and southwestern France. They were part of a tribe known as the Solutreans, who, it is proposed, settled in the area now known as the present-day US Eastern Seaboard. The Solutrean hypothesis claims that over the next 6,000 years, their hunting and gathering culture spread to the American deserts and the Canadian tundra, and perhaps into South America. Evidence for this spread is found in the distinctive style of their projectile points and other clues within the archaeological record. Comparing projectile points from both Europe and Asia, Stanford and Bradley hypothesize that the Solutreans were the first settlers who brought to North America what was previously known as the Clovis culture. DNA records support the Solutrean hypothesis, as mitochondrial DNA testing revealed some unexpected links between Europe and North America. 3% of Native Americans who were tested have mtDNA from a different haplogroup than the others, whose mtDNA is from haplogroups A, B, C, or D. This haplogroup of the 3%, called X, was found to be particularly high in some tribes, such as the Ojibways of the Great Lakes. Genetic anthropologists state that the presence of X in North America points to an early migration from Europe. Furthermore, by examining the mutations within haplogroup X, scientists are able to use that genetic clock to estimate when these early Europeans arrived, and they have come up with two time ranges, either between 36,000 and 23,000 years ago, or between 17,000 and 12,000 years ago. Despite the staunch and steadfast denial by the American historical establishment of even the possibility of any transatlantic voyages prior to 1492 CE, two respected scientists have now broken ranks and had the temerity to suggest a high degree of probability for an early voyage from Europe to America, when mankind was primitive, to say the least, and boat-building skills were in their infancy. Other DNA studies indicate that the ancestors of the Native American peoples who crossed the land bridge across the Bering Strait from Asia pushed an existing population southward as they spread throughout the continent. The descendants of these displaced peoples now inhabit Tierra del Fuego, and their DNA indicates a Polynesian origin. Thus, modern science has blown a hole a mile wide in the official position that Columbus was first, by proving that both the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans had been crossed during that mysterious time known as prehistory. Let us now examine in some detail the vast body of hard evidence for transoceanic voyages that has been so summarily dismissed or ignored by American academics since Columbus was officially declared the first to discover America. Chapter 1. Fantasy versus Fact. We live in a fantasy world, a world of illusion. The great task in life is to find reality. Iris Murdoch. Oscar Wilde once famously declared, "Many people discovered America before Columbus, dear boy, but most of them had the good sense to keep quiet about it." Most early visitors to the New World indeed did keep quiet about it. They came for trade and profit, and thus needed to protect their source of supply in order to maintain a business monopoly. Transatlantic and transpacific voyages were frequent and are recorded in the mythology of Central and South American religions, in pre-Columbian art, and in hard archaeological fact. Yet American academic opinion denies this absolutely, and makes the rigid and dogmatic allegation that Columbus was the first to cross the Atlantic in 1492, and that diffusion of Native American flora and fauna has occurred only since then. For any American academic to question this rigid belief is to commit professional suicide as a historian in the US. This has resulted in another flawed archaeological axiom. The ground rules for archaeology state specifically, albeit they are unwritten, that any site that predates 1492 in the US must be Native American in origin and cannot possibly have been occupied by anyone else prior to that date. It has been argued elsewhere that the primacy of the Columbus voyage is proven by the lack of any bona fide evidence to the contrary. That is not to say that there is no such evidence, but rather that all contrary evidence has been condemned, dismissed, or devalued by the academic hierarchy, who are supposedly the custodians of public education. In this work, we shall summarise some of the more compelling evidence that has been discovered by scholars and researchers of repute who absolutely refute this blinkered attitude. We will also detail the shipbuilding and navigational skills employed by these ancient mariners, cite the economic imperatives that provoked their voyages, and list the evidence to be found on both sides of the ocean that proves, irrefutably, that Columbus was a latecomer to transatlantic exploration. An essential part of the Solutrean hypothesis was the rationale that drove these people to move. During the last years of the Ice Age, hunter-gatherer societies were even more vulnerable than usual to variations in the food supply. So, when that was nearing exhaustion, they had one simple and brutal alternative: move or starve. According to Stanford and Bradley, the Solutreans sailed in skin boats, skirting the edge of the polar ice cap and living off the sea life, just as much as the modern-day Inuit people still do. Eventually, they reached the shores of North America and began to spread, ultimately mixing with the local population. The economic imperative provides a vital key in understanding why groups of people move, travel, and seek to trade with one another. Future historians could not plausibly begin to understand the complexities of our modern-day international relations without first accepting and understanding our current dependence on oil to fuel our economies. Nor, for example, can we, looking back to the Victorian era, attempt to understand the harshness of Victorian life without understanding their society's reliance on iron and coal, which was the mainstay of their economy. It has ever been thus. The reliable supply of whatever was considered as the vital ingredient for life, prestige, or prosperity is the key to understanding the survival of our species and the rise and fall of empires throughout history. This was even more important in the distant past, when technology was in its infancy, and when mankind had not yet learned enough about metallurgy to smelt metallic ores. In the early Bronze Age, before man had discovered the art of smelting copper and tin, sources of raw natural copper and alluvial tin were vital. These were the raw materials for all metal tools, agricultural implements, and above all, weaponry. The 20th century arms race between the old superpowers of Russia and the US was nothing new. In fact, it was a situation as old as the history of civilization itself. In his masterwork, Studies in Ancient Technology, R.J. Forbes remarked, Much of ancient history could be rewritten as a struggle for the domination of quarries and ore deposits or metal supplies. Developments in the history of metallurgy always dictate what kind of mineral deposit is exploitable and at what date. In the Bronze Age, the skill of the smiths permitted them to use only stream or alluvial tin and not vein cassiterite. The relatively few sources of alluvial tin, juxtaposed to copper in the enormous quantities that were required, not just for armies, but for adornment, for agriculture, and for tools, made the steady and reliable supply of these metals absolutely vital. In fact, writing in a history of technology, Singer suggests that it was not until Roman times that vein cassiterite could be used. Therefore, survival in the Bronze Age absolutely depended on finding supplies of alluvial tin. Reliable and plentiful supplies of copper are equally essential, and natural copper deposits from around the world take this form. On the top of the deposit is pure or native copper, below that oxidized copper such as malachite, below that an enriched sulfide zone containing impurities like arsenic, and below that sulfides alone. Therefore, finding a cheap source of copper was the lure that launched the quests of mariners from the ancient Middle East who sailed all over the world's oceans. These exploratory voyages began in the 6th millennium BCE and didn't stop until the Iron Age. The secretive nature of these explorations and the trackless nature of the world's oceans kept this knowledge from the history books. Once the traders had learned of the location of the New World resources, they ensured that the commerce across the oceans continued for their own personal profit. The world's largest deposits of native copper were found, and can still be found, near the Great Lakes of North America. There are only two places in the world where native copper occurs naturally in abundant quantities, and both are in the Americas. The smaller is in Bolivia, near the headwaters of the Amazon. The other, which produces vast quantities, is at Lake Superior, at the upper peninsula of Michigan, and on the lake island of Isle Royale. Mining and the fashioning of copper weapons were carried on there from the 6th millennium BCE to 1000 BCE. This dating is very significant indeed, because it indicates that the use of copper began at about the same time in America as around the Black Sea and the Middle East. If this use is simply a coincidence, it is a very strange one, especially as the stone mauls used for shaping and forming the copper were of a type used for early metalworking in the Old World. The mines on Isle Royale did not go out of use until 1000 BCE. Just as we cannot account for the supply of native copper used in the Old World without allowing for the exploitation of this North American source, also, we can find no evidence in the New World that anything like enough metal was used there to account for the actual output of the mines. The North American metal was exported, although as the years went by, more copper came to be used in the Americas. It has been estimated that the workings at Isle Royale and the Upper Peninsula of Michigan represented a total production of between 250,000 and 750,000 tons of copper. Apparently no one knows who the miners were, but a Chippewa oral legend claims that their forefathers drove out a white race, which might have been the miners. At the beginning of the Bronze Age, arsenical bronze was the first development, but it was soon found to be too dangerous to handle, and as a result, tin bronze began to come into use from 3500 to 3200 BCE. Egypt started using bronze sometime about 2600 BCE. However, the sources of ancient Egyptian and Cypriot tin are supposedly unknown. We should state that there were only two possible sources for the amount of alluvial tin needed. West Africa, from present-day Ghana, is one possibility, and the other, and most probably the principal source, is vast amounts of accessible alluvial tin from the Amazon basin in South America. Ocean crossing. One common misconception that tends to inhibit understanding of the maritime skills of our early ancestors lies deeply rooted in the landman's fear of the sea. Those with no maritime experience simply do not know that it takes far less energy to transport goods over water than it does over land. Furthermore, the same people do not know the power or the reliability of ocean winds and currents. These two facts have distorted our perceptions for far too long. Because of the trackless nature of the sea, comparative distances are also difficult or impossible to estimate by the landlubber. For example, most people labour under the false assumption that it is easier to traverse the Mediterranean from end to end than to cross the Atlantic. Yet the distance from shore to shore across the Atlantic is actually shorter than the length of the Mediterranean. Crossing the Atlantic is actually easier than traversing the Mediterranean. The pattern of winds and currents makes crossing the Atlantic and the subsequent return voyage to Europe relatively easy. The two great, almost circular currents ensure this, aided and abetted by the prevailing winds. Anyone sailing off the coast of Africa who just left their craft at the mercy of the elements would almost inevitably be taken by the currents and the prevailing winds to the Caribbean. The circular patterns of the currents and winds would then again take the craft across the Atlantic in the direction of the British Isles via the Gulf Stream. Whether or not the first people to sail across the Atlantic did so by design or by accident will never be established, but cross it they did, in great numbers and repeatedly, over a prolonged span of time. This can be stated with complete confidence, as the evidence for these voyages can be found in abundant quantities on both sides of the ocean. For example, some American archaeologists have estimated that over 500,000 tons of copper were removed from the mines near Lake Superior, yet only a tiny proportion of this has been located in burial mounds and archaeological sites actually on the American continent. American author and researcher Gunnar Thompson speculates that the bulk of the copper was exported overseas. Another bizarre anomaly has yet to be explained. Assays made and reported in 1991 show that some of the copper artifacts found in North American burial mounds were not made from pure copper at all, but from zinc-copper alloys of Mediterranean origin. Who were these ancient ocean travellers, and who were the principal intercontinental traders? Did they leave any discernible traces or evidence of their visits to the Americas? The Phoenicians dominated early transatlantic trade, but by the beginning of the second millennium BCE, the Minoans of Crete and Thera, now Santorini, were also heavily involved in trade that reached across the North Atlantic Ocean to Mexico and further north to the Great Lakes. They were the principal carriers of pure native copper that originated from Upper Michigan and Isle Royale. The role of the Minoans in bringing metals and corn, maize, across the Atlantic is confirmed by two gold corncob rings that were found at an archaeological site in Crete and dated to the second millennium BCE. Writers from ancient Egypt described the two-way river of the ocean that had the capacity to carry vessels rapidly across the sea and from America. We will later describe a considerable body of evidence that demonstrates that Egypt initiated its own transatlantic voyages and was not entirely dependent on Phoenician or Cypriot traders. Furthermore, Harold Sterling Gladwin repeatedly drew attention to cultural features and objects, particularly pottery, that demonstrate that several American tribes had contact with parts of the Old World, such as the Mediterranean as well as the Orient. The various artistic styles that he listed point to direct voyages between the Old World and America over 2,000 years ago. In our investigations, we need to research the travels of both the Minoans and Phoenicians. They traded with and supplied the ancient empires of Egypt and Babylon. In fact, for almost the entire Bronze Age, the Egyptians were largely dependent on Phoenician merchant ships that brought ingots of copper and tin from the New World. The Phoenicians, who were as poor in metals as the Egyptians, made fortunes out of the maritime metals trade. Indeed, a model of the Phoenician god Melkart was found in Rio Balsas, Mexico. Furthermore, there was an identification of Hittite glyphs on obsidian discs by Mrs. Ruth Verrill in the state of Utah. Archaeologists and explorers have found Phoenician inscriptions in Peru, as well as ceramic portraits of the ancient mariners. Semitic people in ancient Peru? The ancient visitors from Phoenicia carved graffiti on stone walls, boulders, and memorial tablets that were found in the Amazon basin and all across the eastern United States. These Punic Iberian travellers were more literary than their Minoan predecessors. After all, they gave us our alphabet. These Amazon carvings are within the vicinity of the principal tin deposits that were exploited in the Bronze Age. The doctrinaire scholars, who have been unable to locate the ancient sources of tin that were used in the Old World to make bronze, may need to cast their nets further afield and look across the Atlantic Ocean. The relationship between the black leaders of Egypt and the Phoenicians around 670 BCE may help to explain how a Mediterranean figure with a flowing beard and turned-up shoes appears in association with black figures in ancient Mexico, and how certain elements of Phoenician artifacts, including the model of the aforementioned Phoenician god Melkart, have been unearthed in the Americas within contexts that are related to the African-Egyptian presence there. The largest ocean-going ships at the height of Phoenician power were built at Tartessus on the Atlantic coast of Spain. This port was where tin was imported and stored before being further shipped onward to its final destination. Homer wrote that tin came out of the Atlantic, and as we have already mentioned, at that time there were only two sources that could supply the alluvial tin in the vast quantities necessary, one being in Africa and the other in the Americas. Epigraphers use the word Tartessian to describe the script that its residents used, a Paleo-Hispanic language that proves to be no more than a dialectical version of Phoenician. The ships of Tarshish, a term that eventually came to signify a type of ship and one capable of long sea voyages, were the largest seagoing vessels known to the Semitic world. Long sea voyages indeed, as Tartessian inscriptions have been found in New England, such as those at Mount Hope Bay, Bristol, Rhode Island, West Virginia, and Ohio. The first authenticated find of an engraved Phoenician tablet in a North American archaeological context was a Tartessian inscription found in 1838 and excavated from a burial chamber at the base of Mammoth Mound in Moundsville, West Virginia. Although the Tartessian alphabet had not then been deciphered, the similarity of the inscription to Iberian writing was recognised, and in the contemporary reports of the dig, the mound and its contents were attributed to European visitors. Further east, on the island of Corvo in the Azores, a pot full of Phoenician coins dating from 330 to 320 BCE was discovered in 1749. Bimini Road. The Bimini Road, also known as the Bimini Wall, is a strange underwater rock formation off the coast of North Bimini Island in the Bahamas. The structure consists of a 0.50-mile-long northeast-southwest linear feature composed of roughly rectangular limestone blocks resembling a road or harbour wall. Although the road is generally considered to be a naturally occurring geological feature, there is still some debate surrounding the possibility that it is in fact a man-made structure, possibly that of an ancient road or wall. This theory is one championed by Robert Marx and Dmitry Rebikov, who believed that the structure at Bimini was a sunken wall or perhaps even the remnants of an Atlantean city. We must point out at this stage that normally we would run a million miles when hearing any mention of Atlantis. This said, however, a variety of intriguing finds and similarities to other ancient sites may link our Phoenician ancestors to the Bimini Road. In 1969, marine engineer and oceanographer Dmitry Rebikov asserted that the Bimini Road formation was similar, if not identical, to numerous other ancient man-made harbours discovered throughout the Mediterranean. Finds such as stone anchors and harbour foundations found at Cosa, Italy, Acco, Israel, and Samos, Greece, among others, appear similar to the apparent stone anchors and harbour-like structure at Bimini. Cosa, Acco, and Samos were also sites visited and occupied by the ancient Phoenicians, Romans, and Greeks. If these ancient groups had indeed travelled to the New World, they may have used similar harbour construction techniques that were commonplace in the Mediterranean at Bimini. Away from the hypothesis that the structure is a harbour, author Frank Joseph asserts that the structure in fact resembles the massive ancient walls found at the Phoenician and Roman site of Lyxus in today's Morocco. While there are some similarities between numerous ancient sites and the Bimini complex, it is difficult to come to a solid conclusion on the nature of the site. Could it be man-made? Or is it evidence of the beauty of nature? The only conclusion that can be brought to this discussion is that further investigation of the structure is required. If future evidence emerges that concludes the site is man-made, then we shouldn't look to an Atlantean hypothesis. The site has been carbon dated to being between 2,000 and 4,000 years old. We could perhaps consider the notion that this is a Phoenician port situated off the coast of the United States. The age of the structure would fit within the Phoenician and Roman period, and it may have sunk beneath the waves. Whatever the nature of Bimini, we should keep an open mind to possibilities. However, for the time being, evidence points toward a natural phenomenon. Time will tell. Chapter 2. Corn in Egypt and Egyptians in the Americas. Jacob saw that there was corn in Egypt. Genesis chapter 42, verse 1. Some children who have grown up in the Western world since the advent of universal education are familiar with the expression corn in Egypt. It is one of the most familiar biblical quotes of them all. The question that arises from that expression is one of supreme importance to isolationist and diffusionist academics alike. What plant does the word corn refer to? To diffusionists, it is held to mean maize or Indian corn, a plant native to the Americas. To the isolationists, it is a generic term that refers to wheat and any other European or Middle Eastern native grain. This potentially vexatious question was apparently answered in the early years of Egyptology when a Swiss botanist, Alphonse de Candolle, conducted a somewhat cursory study of carvings of ancient Egyptian temples in 1885. Having toured a few tombs in Giza, he asserted definitively that there was absolutely no reliable evidence of maize agriculture in Egypt or anywhere else in the Old World until after Columbus's first voyage in 1492. Significantly, it was only after this fateful pronouncement had been made that the isolationist scholars proclaimed that it was Columbus alone who was responsible for the transmission of American flora and fauna to worldwide diaspora. Apparently, no one in the isolationist camp ever questioned how, on the basis of such a cursory and incomplete survey, de Candolle could state so definitively that there was no evidence of maize agriculture either in Egypt or elsewhere in the Old World. His word was taken as final and absolute. Before we examine the wealth of evidence that proves de Candolle to be just plain wrong, let us briefly consider the fate of those scientists and academics who have the integrity and courage to question the prevailing party line that Columbus was first. Scholars who report evidence that is contrary to the New World isolationist paradigm are immediately ostracized. When Smithsonian archaeologist Betty Meggers found Japanese ceramics at an Ecuadorian site, she dated the pottery to the 3rd millennium BCE. Thus, Japanese ships had sailed across the Atlantic and established a colony in South America. Despite the fact that her evidence, methodology, and conclusions were beyond reproach, her colleagues promptly denounced Dr. Meggers. Of course, being a woman in a so-called male occupation did not aid her cause. When Aben Norton Horsford found evidence of a Nordic colony in New England, the novelist Samuel Eliot Morrison roundly castigated him. When African-American scholar Professor Ivan Van Sertimer reported evidence of voyages to ancient Mexico involving black Africans, he was ridiculed as a racist in an anthropological journal. Tor Heyerdahl is still regarded by some Norwegian scholars as a pseudo-scientist and crackpot for suggesting that Egyptians could have sailed to Mexico. The fundamentalist attack squads ridiculed former British submarine commander Gavin Menzies, who claimed that Ming Chinese Admiral Zheng He had sailed around the world almost a century before Columbus. Menzies was promptly condemned by many anthropologists and historians, despite the vast amount of evidence supporting his thesis. All reasonable hypotheses in any academic context should always be subjected to rigorous peer review by other scholars, but that review should be not merely deep and analytical, but also fair, reasonable, and open-minded. Let us now muddy the waters of the diffusionist/isolationist arguments with a few uncomfortable facts. Firstly, let us establish how plant species can cross nearly 3,000 miles of ocean. Let us take maize for our primary example. Seeds or kernels from the domesticated maize plant are too large to be transported by migratory birds. Furthermore, the corn cobs could not float by themselves all the way to Europe, Africa, or Asia, and if they did, they would be ruined by prolonged immersion in salt water. If the biblical expression corn in Egypt does refer to maize, then it would constitute solid proof that ancient mariners from the Middle East had crossed the Atlantic Ocean and returned many centuries before Columbus. The question is, when did maize, a New World plant, first reach the Old World? If Old World traders succeeded in sailing between their home ports and ancient America, then they may have significantly influenced the rise of New World civilizations and provided an essential food supply to the empires of the Old World. From the evidence that has been garnered from ancient Egyptian temple carvings, New World maize reached the Middle East at the apparent dawn of civilization. We do not have to rely on the carvings of maize to prove that it was a common crop in ancient Egypt. Actual corn cobs have been found very early on when Egyptology was in its infancy. As early as 1819, Egyptian archaeologist J.J. Rifo reported that maize had been found inside a sarcophagus, a previously unopened casket that was nearly 3,000 years old. The earliest carvings of corn cobs occur in tombs that were constructed during the reign of Pharaoh Snefru, also known as Sneferu, 2620 to 2547 BCE. Columbus's first voyage in 1492 undoubtedly opened up the Americas to European conquest and bestowed upon Spain a vast hoard of New World gold. What Columbus did not do was bring the world's most important food plant, maize, to the Old World. That had actually happened about 5,000 years ago.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.